to mime.
See, that's a truth.
The music industry's changed dramatically from when I first started in it, so I think these days, if you're going to be successful, you've got to understand the whole business. So from just being a songwriter, I think now I'm involved in the whole business and every different kind of aspect of it, which is more interesting, but a whole lot more work and a whole lot less sleep, but it's great, so I'm happy.
John's a very busy man. That's probably one of the hardest things, you know. He's got about 50 projects on at once, and whenever we have some downtime, he's always playing other stuff that's going on, but he seems to have a really kind of quick brain to me.
John, without question, is one of the nicest people I've ever met in the music industry. There is not a bad bone in this guy's body, which is a shame, really, because he should be a bit nuts.
Well, this is how some of my meetings with Simon Cowell used to go back in the day. I used to get in his office, and then Simon would go,
"You are the most boring person I've ever met."
Followed by,
"Words can't describe just how dull you really are."
And then the odd, but occasionally he'd pick up the odd song, and I love him for that. Thank you, Simon.
I think he learnt a lot by coming in here. I mean, the interesting thing is that you write a hip-hop song, and everyone around you as you're writing it says it's fantastic, the singer, the engineers, the producers, etc. You come in this office, you sit down here, very sterile environment, and you hear it through my ears. And it's an awakening. And what I taught John was how difficult it is to be a writer of one of the few grade A pop records per year.
Beautiful. You're finished.
Awesome.
You're finished.
Right.
Do I know how many number ones and top tens I've had? I know of two number ones in the UK. And, I don't know, 10 top tens? Something like that? Ish. I don't know. I don't know.
In fact, John's had 5 number ones and 18 top 10 hits worldwide. Even a song he wrote for an anti-smoking ad ended up in the charts. And when the Fame Academy needed a songwriting coach, inevitably they turned to John.
The students struggle to combine all their ideas, so songwriting guru John Mclaughlin is summoned to show them how to write together.
Say, well, please, what you've got melody-wise just now.
I can't believe the hell it is.
Nothing, no.
Okay.
I mean, it's only a 2-minute song as well, so you only want a wee short verse. Take a leaf at the old YouTube bit, which is sing hardly anything over the top of it, but make a nice, strong melody, you know?
I'm reaching out for the stars, you pull them down for you.
It's a step in the right direction.
Coming together, isn't it?
Yeah.
All right.
Thank God for John.
Thank God for John.
He's got this ability to talk to the kids, as he always says, it's all for the kids. In his lyrics, he knows how to make it kind of for everyone, which is a hard thing to do without making something sound either cheesy or too young and condescending.
The Boston stuff I really like because it's introducing kids like my 8-year-old daughter to something that's a bit spikier, you know, and she'll pogo around the room. That's what I go to school for. Instead of the kids growing up thinking Nelly's the bee's knees, you know, there's Charlie from Busted, and he looks the part. He's the one with the eyebrows, isn't he?
Myself and Steve Robson co-wrote it with the boys. They were writing, we were writing, making the record sound the way we wanted, a kind of garagey type feel, and that's what we got, and I think that I'm so delighted that it just worked, that the people picked up on it. That's what I go to school for.